Hello everyone, I am Professor Manish Mamtani from the Department of Geology and Geophysics, Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur. I am happy to give a seminar today, which is a part of the IUGS Tech Task Seminar Series on the topic Nanotectonics, the Future of Structural Geology. This TechTask seminar is primarily based on data from SEM, EBSD and TEM analysis that I have performed on the slip second shear zone schists from the Swedish Caledonides. And this is an outcome of a research collaboration between myself and my friends and colleagues at the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology in Germany, namely Professor Dr. Agnes Contney and Dr. Boris Resnick. And this particular research work that involved an integration of SEM EBSD as well as TEM studies on magnetite has already been published in the Journal of Structural Geology in 2020. I would like to acknowledge the Alexander von Humboldt Foundation and the German Academic Exchange Service, that is the DAAD in Germany, for providing me the opportunity to pursue this integrated study on the deformation mechanism of magnetite. A large number of people have actually helped in this particular study, and they are all listed here in the acknowledgements section. A lot of people helped with the sample preparation and analysis of EBSD in the Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur in India, and several scientists have helped in sample preparation and TEM analysis in Germany. I am very grateful to all of them. The primary question before we can even think about nanotectonics is, why is nanoscale investigation important in structural geology? And in my opinion and my perspective, following are the reasons why nanoscale investigations are important. All deformation at the microscopic, meso, as well as macroscopic scales is eventually rooted in and initiated by processes that occur at the crystal lattice scale in a mineral. This is one of the most important reasons why nanoscale processes are important. Moreover, if we just browse through a large number of publications in journals like the Journal of Structural Geology or Tectonophysics, we find that a lot of research in structural geology is focused on strain localization, and several studies are being carried out that involve numerical modeling and stress distribution during microstructure evolution. However, the actual development of a microstructure initiates at the atomistic scale or at the atomic scale. Hence, the response of crystal lattice to the applied tectonic stress is an area that needs to be explored in structural geology. Just like orientation of far-field tectonic stress and kinematics at the microscopic scale are related, it is expected that kinematics at the atomistic scale must be related to the tectonic stress orientation. This is the philosophy that forms the basis of the present seminar. Now, I have divided my presentation in several parts, and the points that I will cover are as follows. Initially, I will briefly sweep through the definition of nano and tectonics, and then deal with a bit of history, particularly focusing on where the term nanotectonics has been used in sciences. And then I will go to the present context of the use of the term nanotectonics in geoscience, which is my perspective and my way of looking at how to define nanotectonics in geoscience, particularly in the field of structural geology. This will be followed by a detailed presentation of the nanotectonic processes that I and my colleagues have been able to unravel and decipher from magnetite that was located in the schists belonging to the slip second shear zone, Swedish Caledonides. And this part will be a major part of my presentation, which will involve the SEM EBSD data and TEM data. And as I said before, this work has already been published in the Journal of Structural Geology in 2020. And I will finally conclude with what I see personally as are the future possibilities in the field of structural geology, where atomistic modeling and fractal analysis using nanostructures can be applied. So nanotectonics, if we go through the dictionary definition of nano, it means 1/1,000,000th. You see, it could be 1/1,000,000th or part of a nanosecond or nanometer, whatever be the unit, but it is 1/1,000,000th. And the prefix, as we all know, denotes a factor of 10 to the power minus 9. And the word tectonics is taken from tectonicus in Latin or tectonikos in ancient Greek, which implies pertaining to building. And in earth sciences, as we know, the word tectonics is used for processes that control the structure and properties of the earth's crust and its evolution through time. So this is breakup of the term nano and tectonics. So when we are dealing with the structures at a scale of 1/1,000,000,000th, then that would form, technically speaking, nanotectonics. If we do an internet search of the term nanotectonics, then it throws up lots of surprises, because we end up finding that, or rather we end up discovering that nanotectonics is a very commonly used term in the field of inorganic chemistry, and a Google search throws up so many details and web pages that deal with the nanotectonics in chemistry. There is a big group in Bristol in chemistry of, say, for example, Professor Stephen Mann, and his team has been working a lot on what they call molecular tectonics, crystal tectonics, and nanotectonics. Essentially, in the field of chemistry, strategies for the assembly of materials with higher order architecture from inorganic nanoparticle building blocks are collectively termed nanotectonics. If we do internet search and try to dig deep to find or explore the historical account of nanotectonics in geosciences, then we do not get too much of literature. An important paper that pops up is the one which was published by me and my colleagues, which is very recent. That was in the year 2020 in the Journal of Structural Geology. However, There is this book by J.P. Bard, 1986, entitled Microtextures of Igneous and Metamorphic Rocks. And this is actually an English translation of the original French version that was published in the year 1980. So what this tells us is that nanotectonics and geosciences was first used in French publications. And trying to hunt through the book of Bard, we actually find that the term nanotectonics is actually used for crystal growth or deformation processes at the microscopic scale. So, having identified that the term nanotectonic was first used in French literature, I set about hunting for the term nanotectonic in French on the internet, and I was able to identify that Dyckha G in the year 1976 published a work in the Bulletin of the French Society of Mineralogy and Crystallography, where this particular term nanotectonic has been used in reference to the microscopic intracrystalline cavities. So we can safely conclude that prior to the work that was published by me and my colleagues in the Journal of Structural Geology in 2020, the term nanotectonic in geoscience has been used in French publications, and very importantly, it has not been very specifically defined. The term nanotectonic has been used rather loosely and has referred to crystal deformation, as was done by Bard in his works of 1980 and 1986, or it has referred to micro cavities, as was done by Dyckha in 1976. However, in the field of chemistry, the term nanotectonics is very specifically defined, and it has a reference to nanomaterial synthesis. In the field of inorganic chemistry, the term nanotectonics can be traced to have evolved from molecular tectonics and crystal tectonics. Now, coming to the present study of nanotectonics in geoscience, and this is particularly with reference to structural geology. In this particular lecture, nanotectonics refers to the study of nanostructures under the transmission electron microscope in oriented thin films or the oriented fib lamellae of rocks to understand regional tectonics and kinematics. So, in other words, just like structural geologists, we are used to performing kinematics analysis and microstructural analysis in oriented thin sections prepared in the XZ reference frame of the strain ellipsoid, and determine the sense of shear and correlate this kinematics to some regional tectonic events. In the context of nanotectonics, this particular lecture advocates a similar use of nanostructures and nanoprocesses that are observed under the transmission electron microscope to be related to regional tectonics and kinematics. So that is the basic objective of this present seminar. And I intend to drive my point by presenting before you the data that has been generated using an integrated SEM EBST and TEM investigation in magnetite grains from the schists of the slip second shear zone in Swedish Caledonides. The detailed studies related to the field geology and stratigraphy are out of the scope of the present seminar. For our present purpose, it is important for the audience to know that the sense of shear of the rocks is topped towards the northwest. The schists are myelinitized, and this myelinitization has occurred at a temperature of around 550 degrees Celsius temperature. And the mica schists, they contain pure magnetite. And this was already established by Contney and co-workers in an earlier study in the year 2012. The mean magnetic susceptibility of the rocks is known to be quite high because of the presence of magnetite, and the magnetite grains, they are quite eccentric. They have very high aspect ratio, as a consequence of which these rocks have a very high degree of magnetic anisotropy. This is the image of a thin section of the garnet mica schist that is presently under investigation, and it contains garnet with inclusions of quartz, lot of biotite and muscovite that form these mica fish, and the sense of shear is known to be top towards northwest, which is very clear from these shear bands that are pretty obvious at the microscopic scale in the thin section. And it is important to note that this is a thin section which is prepared parallel to the stretching lineation and perpendicular to the foliation, and hence it is a typical XZ section of the strain ellipsoid. Important thing is that these schists contain highly elongated magnetite grains, which is very obvious here shown by the red arrows. This is another thin section of the schist that is under investigation, and it is pretty obvious that the magnetite grains are highly elongated. Their grain size varies between 24 and 104 microns. And the aspect ratio varies between 1.06 to as high as 10.40. It is important to now remember that the present study involves SEM, EBST and TEM investigation of these highly elongated magnetite grains. The SEM, EBST investigation was done in the Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur in India, and the TEM part of the study was done in Karlsruhe Institute of Technology in Germany. Coming to the SEM EBSD part of the study, it was performed, as I already stated, in the IIT Kharagpur in India. Polishing of the thin section was done for 10 hours with non-crystalline colloidal silica solution. And then the sample, that is the thin section, was coated with 5 nanometer carbon layer. And it was then subjected to SEM EBSD analysis in the Central Research Facility at IIT Kharagpur. This was followed by the post-acquisition processing in the Department of Geology and Geophysics, IIT Kharagpur, using the HKL Channel Phi software. And this post-processing helped us in identifying the low and high angle grain boundaries and the region of interest for the TEM studies, which were then performed in Germany. So this is a photomicrograph of the area that was of interest, which contained the elongated magnetite grains, and this was the large area of interest for which the SEM EBSD data were acquired. This is an SEM image of this highly elongated magnetite. The shear sense indicators, such as shear bands, are well preserved and easily observable in this particular area of interest, and that is the magnetite grain. So, when SEM EBSD studies were performed initially on this particular magnetite, we were able to identify presence of some crystallographic variation in the large magnetite grain. So it was clear that there was an area where significantly there were some differences in the crystallographic preferred orientation, and this was the area that was selected for detailed SEM EBSD investigation under a high, that is for high resolution EBSD mapping. This is the high resolution EBSD map of the magnetite, and this helps us in identifying areas across which the misorientation profiles were prepared. So this is one profile marked 1-2, which is across a boundary where there is some variation in crystallography, which is identified by the variation in the blue tint, the blue color in the EBSD map. So the misorientation profile across 1-2 was prepared. Likewise, another profile line was selected. This is mark 3-4, and this is across a boundary where there is a clear distinction in the color from this violet tint to the green tint. And the misorientation profile along profile line 3-4 is presented here. So, based on the misorientation along the profile 1-2, it is clear that there is a 6-degree misorientation across the grain boundary, and this helps us to conclude that this is a low angle grain boundary in the magnetite. On the other hand, the misorientation noted across along the profile 3-4 is very high. It is 26 degrees, as can be seen in the image here, and this is identified as a high angle grain boundary. Also, it is important to note that there is a significant misorientation across the microcrack, which is very clearly visible in the scanning electron microscope image. So now we set about identifying the main region of interest for the transmission electron microscopy, that is TEM studies, which were supposed to be done now in Germany. So this is a magnified image of the overall area of interest. This is the low angle grain boundary, that is the high angle grain boundary. These black dots that are seen in the SEM image, these are the biotite flakes, and microcracks are clearly visible in the SEM image at this particular magnification. This is the EBSD map of the area that is broadly identified from where the fib lamellae are to be extracted for TEM studies. So this is the low angle grain boundary, and when we further magnify this particular part under the scanning electron microscope, we find that there is a biotite grain flake, rather a biotite flake at this low angle grain boundary, and this is the area ROI, that is region of interest 1, that was identified for TEM lamella extraction. Now this is the high angle grain boundary across the profile line 3-4, and when we look at the magnified image of this particular part, we find that the high angle grain boundary is there, which is shown by the blue arrow, and these are the biotite grains in this part of the magnetite. Microcracks are very obvious in this part, and the region of interest 2, ROI2, which is across the high angle grain boundary, is shown here with the blue box, and this is the region from where another lamella was planned to be extracted for TEM studies. Coming to the TEM study of magnetite, which was performed at the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology, Germany. A standard procedure for sample preparation and TEM analysis was followed. The lamella extraction was done using the focused ion beam technique, and this involved coating the thin section with platinum, followed by depositing platinum strap at the identified region of interest. And you would remember that these two regions of interest, ROI1 and ROI2, had been identified across the low angle and high angle grain boundaries using the SEM EBSD studies that were performed in the Indian Institute of Technology, IIT Kharagpur in India. So, after the platinum strap had been deposited on the ROI, the fib lamella preparation was done. This was followed by mounting the fib lamella on fib lift out TEM grid, and then followed it up with the further thinning of the mounted fib lamella to 50 nanometer thickness, and then final polishing and cleaning of the thin film was carried out. The TEM and high resolution TEM investigations were done using the Philips CM200 FEG STTEM in the laboratory for electron microscopy in KIT Karlsruhe, Germany, which was operated at 200 kV. Select area electron diffraction SAED was done using 100 micron condenser aperture at 300 nanometer spot size, and bright field, dark field, weak beam, dark field conditions were used for the TEM analysis. These are standard procedures that are used for TEM studies, and those interested in knowing the details must look at books like Williams and Carter 2009 for in-depth knowledge acquisition. This is an image of how the fib lamella extraction was done. So the step one was depositing the platinum strap in the region of interest. So that is the ROI1 across the low angle grain boundary, and this is the ROI2, which is across the high angle grain boundary. I will now show you a series of images that give you an impression of the process of excavation of fib lamellae from the region of interest. As you can see, a needle is attached to the excavated part of the magnetite fib lamella. And then the extraction process is initiated. The needle moves, you know, it moves along with the excavated fib lamella, and then it is placed on the fib lift out TEM grid. And mind you, this entire process is being, you know, undertaken inside the SEM chamber. And this is an image that shows that finally the fib lamella has been placed on the fib lift out TEM grid inside the SEM chamber. As structural geologists, it is very important for us to keep a track of the tectonic reference frame. And the series of images that I will now present before you highlights this particular aspect. So this is a block diagram of the magnetite grain in the XYZ reference frame. So as I discussed earlier, the thin section that we have is prepared parallel to the stretching lineation and perpendicular to the foliation. So essentially it is the XZ section of the strain ellipsoid, and the magnetite grain is observed in this XZ section of the strain ellipsoid. Within this magnetite grain, we have identified the areas where there are low angle and high angle grain boundaries. And across these grain boundaries, we have our two regions of interest, ROI1 and ROI2. And this sense of shear is topped towards northwest, as was discussed earlier during this presentation. This is the SEM image during the fib lamella extraction. These are the micro cracks. That is the XZ direction. That is northwest inside the SEM chamber. The ROI1, fib lamella 1, well, that is already excavated from here. It has been extracted from here. So the remaining part is shown here. And this platinum strap is for the region of interest 2. And the strap is clearly seen right now here in this image, because this image was taken before extracting the fib lamella 2. Through the present series of images, I will present before you the care that was taken to keep a track of the geographic reference frame during the fib lamella extraction in this present study. So this is the northwest direction inside the SEM chamber, and the fib lamella extraction excavation is being done from the platinum strap that you can already see in that first image. So I am now going to show you the care that was taken to keep a track of the reference frame, the geographic reference frame, while extracting the fib lamella, by discussing the example of fib lamella 2, which is from the region of interest 2. And remember that the region of interest 2 is across the high angle grain boundary. So this is the northwest direction. The reference frame right now is the XZ section. Fib lamella excavation is in process. So there are a series of images that show the different steps of progress of the fib lamella excavation. Finally, a needle to which the lamella will be attached, the platinum needle, it is now seen in the image, and the needle is now attached to the fib lamella. Now we are seeing this image from the other side in the SEM chamber. So compare the northwest direction right now of this image with the northwest in the earlier image. Now the lamella has been detached from the excavated part, and the needle is raised further. The lamella has now been fully excavated, and now it is being placed in the fib lift out TEM grid. And finally, the lamella has been placed on the lift out TEM grid. Now here, the northwest direction is clearly known for the fib lamella. In these series of images, I will further show how care was taken to recognize, identify, and maintain the orientation of fib lamella in the tectonic and the geographic reference frame. The fib lamella is the very small grain, you know, like a grain of rice, which is seen there on the TEM grid. This is a high magnification image of the sample of the fib lamella. And that is the fib lamella SEM image. This is the northwest direction. Now, please note that the rough side is towards the southeast, and the smooth side in the lamella is towards the northwest. This helps us to identify the direction and keep a track of this direction, irrespective of how the lamella would be rotated inside the SEM chamber, whether you are seeing it from this view or any other view. So this is the fib lamella 2 across the high angle grain boundary. It is This is the reference frame for the block diagram X, Y, and Z. So when the fib lamella has been excavated from the XZ section of the magnetite grain, then what we are now seeing is that the fib lamella is parallel to the XY plane because the excavation was done perpendicular to the XZ section. The rough side, as I mentioned earlier, is the southeast, and the smooth side is the northwest. So this is the northwest direction. Just like we can use a knife to thin and slice cheese, similarly, further thinning of the fib lamella is done to a thickness of 50 nanometers so that electron transmission can be achieved through the fib lamella. So the thinning is in progress here. And finally, the final thin fib lamella can be seen here. The reference frame is very clear here. The fib lamella is this particular fib lamella, which is across the high angle grain boundary, is parallel to the XY reference frame, and that is the northwest direction. So, looking at both the fib lamella in the tectonic reference frame, we can see that the fib lamella 1 across region of interest 1 is oblique to the X, Y, and Z axis of the strain ellipsoid. And within this lamella, we can see the low angle grain boundary and the two parts of this magnetite across the grain boundary are marked M1 and M2. Then we have fib lamella 2, which is in the region of interest 2. And within this, we can identify the high angle grain boundary. And three parts of the magnetite are marked across the high angle grain boundary, marked M3, M4, and M5. And interestingly, a triangular facet can be seen in this fib lamella, which was identified as biotite. These are the two images of the magnetite fib lamellae through the low angle grain boundary and the high angle grain boundary. This is the fib lamella 1, where you can see the low angle grain boundary. The grains M1 and M2 are marked here across this grain boundary. On the other hand, in the fib lamella 2, high angle grain boundary is clear, and the M3, M4, M5 mark the parts of magnetite grain across the high angle grain boundary, and this triangular facet is the biotite. TEM study of fib lamella 1 across the low angle grain boundary was done, and these are some of the images and the imaging results for this particular lamella. So under dark field imaging conditions, it was possible to identify at the contact between these two magnetite subgrains a transition zone which is around 14 nanometers in thickness. And this transition zone under the weak beam condition clearly looks like an area
where some high strain has accommodated or strain localization has taken place. So that is M1, M2 part of the magnetite grain. And this particular pattern is identified as Moire fringes. This pattern, you know, is formed by superposition of the lattices or overlapping lattices. Because there is no significant twisting or evidence of any significant rotation in this transition zone and in these Moire fringes, therefore these are identified as translational Moire fringes at the magnetite low angle grain boundary. In contrast, when we do the TEM imaging of the fib lamella 2, which is across the high angle grain boundary, we find that there is presence of twisted, you see, fringes at this particular high angle grain boundary. And these are identified as rotational Moire fringes. This is a high magnification image of the rotational Moire fringes. And it is naturally quite different from the translational Moire fringes that could be identified under the TEM at the low angle grain boundary. This is HR-TEM, high resolution TEM image of nanostructures at magnetite low angle grain boundary. That is the M1 and M2 part of the magnetite. This is the FFT diffractogram, fast Fourier transformation diffractogram for M2. And that is the FFT diffractogram for M1. And the misorientation here is identified to be, or is calculated to be, 6 degrees. And interestingly, this is the 6 degree misorientation across the LAGB that was also identified from the misorientation profile using the SEM EBSD data that was obtained in IIT Kharagpur in India. The other interesting thing is presence of polygonal domains in the TEM image. When we look at high magnification, we find that there are polygonal domains which are identified by these typical 120 degree triple junctions. And also in the HRTEM image, we are able to identify some distorted atomic planes that are recognized from this blurred contrast in the image. And the inverse FFT image of this blurred part indicates presence of dislocations. Interesting nanostructures are also identified in the HRTEM image of magnetite in the fib lamella 2, which is across the high angle grain boundary. The FFT diffractograms reveal that the misorientation in the lattice is 26 degrees, and this fits very well with the misorientation map for the high angle grain boundary that was prepared from the SEM EBSD data. also linear bands parallel to not one direction are identified in this HRTEM image in FIB-lamella2. When we look at the HRTEM image of this magnetite at high angle grain boundary, we find very interesting nanostructures like the linear bands that are parallel to not one and zigzag atomic arrangement. The IIFFT image of this zigzag part establishes that these are nanotwins. At the same time, this HRTEM also image also shows some blurred atomic arrangement, and the IIFFT image processing reveals presence of stacking faults and dislocations in these blurred areas of the HRTEM image. So all the nanostructures at the low and high angle grain boundary in this magnetite grain, which is investigated under the TEM, reveals the presence of intracrystalline deformation of magnetite by dislocation creep. Finally, as structural geologists, it is extremely important for us to relate the FIB lamellae to the tectonic reference frame and also the nanostructures like the translational and the rotational Moir fringes to the regional kinematics. For doing this, it is important to visualize the FIB lamellae once again in the tectonic reference frame. So this is the block diagram that shows the XZ section of the strain ellipsoid in which the magnetite grain was studied under the light microscope, as well as EBSD data were acquired under the SEM. The FIB lamella 1 was excavated perpendicular to this XZ section across the low angle grain boundary, but it was oblique to the XY as well as the XZ section of the strain ellipsoid. On the other hand, FIB lamella 2 was excavated perpendicular to the XZ section of this strain ellipsoid, but at the same time it is also parallel to the XY plane of the strain ellipsoid. The translational Moir fringes are present in the FIB lamella 1, and the rotational Moir fringes are present in the FIB lamella 2. And it is clear from these images that the sense of rotation inferred from nanostructures is in sync with regional kinematics. That is, the sense of movement is supporting the top to the northwest sense of shear. So to conclude, nanotectonics in geosciences, how do we define it, or what is it? According to me, and this is purely my perspective, that the study of nanostructures under TEM in oriented FIB lamella of rocks to understand regional tectonics and kinematics can be defined as nanotectonics in geosciences. Question is, should we use the term nanogeotectonics in geosciences to avoid confusion or overlap with the usage of the term nanotectonics in chemistry? This statement is important to be discussed or debated because as we have seen during the earlier part of this presentation, that nanotectonics is a very well established term in inorganic chemistry, and the usage is in a totally different perspective. However, as the great William Shakespeare stated, what's in a name? That which we call a rose by any other name would smell as sweet. More important than the name is how can the knowledge of nanostructures in oriented fib lamellae be exploited in geosciences? This is where I would like to now discuss the future studies, nanostructures in oriented fib lamellae parallel to exert section. This is a prospective area where a lot of more work can be done and needs to be done. And we have to learn a lot and adopt a lot from material sciences. There is a lot of work that has been now done on extracting fib lamellae from plan view. You see, so far it is quite common to extract fib lamellae, but these lamellae are extracted from a section, you see, which is perpendicular to the plan view. If we will be able to extract fib lamellae that will be parallel to the plan view, then in the context of structural geology, this can be very useful in studying fib lamellae parallel to the exert section of the strain ellipsoid. And this will be the correct reference frame to correlate nanokinematics with regional tectonics. There is a lot of work that is also being done on atomistic modeling, and this is one such review paper that I came across, where small, you see, nano fractures or nano cracks are being studied, and how these cracks will respond to variation in changes at the atomistic scale is being, you see, modeled. So future studies in geosciences can be targeted to atomistic modeling. And these are a few examples from which we could, you see, learn how will nanostructures in oriented fib lamellae evolve in response to variation in regional deformation and tectonic stress. This could be an interesting research problem that would require atomistic modeling in. Another study that came to my notice was this particular one, which helps me to also, you know, envisage that a lot of studies can be initiated on atomistic modeling of nanostructures. Particularly keeping in mind that failure of a material is controlled by nanostructures, and atomistic modeling can enhance understanding of response of nanostructures to variation in stress. So future nanotectonic studies in structural geology could involve integrating TEM data with atomistic simulations. For this, fib lamellae must be extracted parallel to the exert section of the strain ellipsoid. nanostructures in XZ section parallel fib lamella will provide information of nanokinematics and its relation to regional tectonics, orientation of slip bands, dislocations, and other nanostructures in the tectonic and geographic reference frame can be useful in more realistic atomistic modeling that is closer to simulating natural systems. Atomistic modeling with knowledge of tectonic reference frame vis-a-vis nanostructures can help model response of nanostructures to variation in stress in natural systems. And this approach, in my opinion, will help in studies dealing with the flaw development and flaw reactivation. This knowledge in turn can be applied to problems such as stability of radioactive waste disposal sites or repositories or natural disasters such as landsliding. So I strongly believe that this type of approach that involves nanotectonic studies integrating TEM data with atomistic simulations and the study of nanostructures in oriented fib lamellae can not only be helpful in fundamental studies in structural geology, but it can also have a lot of applications in problems that affect human life. Patterns in nature is a game of scales. So I can end my talk with a few fun slides. Of course, keeping in mind that I want to comment on what could be the future applications of the study of nanostructures and nanotectonics. So here are a few images which highlight that the structures in nature look similar at different scales, from the field to the microscopic scale to the nanoscale. They all look similar, and these are all polygons in the present case. And this only goes on to establish that self-similarity in patterns in nature is true for meso through micro to nanoscales. I would like to therefore conclude on a philosophical note that this type of self-similarity indicates that there is a lot of scope of performing fractal studies using nanostructures. And as the great Benoit Mandelbrot stated, that a fractal is a way of seeing infinity. And on the other hand, William Blake stated to see a world in a grain of sand. I end on this philosophical note that fractal analysis of TEM images and nanostructures may be the future of geosciences. Thank you very much for your attention.